We welcome Damon Severson to the show. Let's jump right in on the contract. How did it feel to sign that deal and get it taken care of?
Yeah, obviously a little bit of relief and also just, you know, big time excitement coming in, you know, down the stretch here was, a little bit close to camp and a little bit nerve wracking at times, but I was confident that we were going to come to an agreement, and it's part of the business side of the game that everybody kind of has to understand. So it's definitely an exciting time and look forward to the season, and I like the direction that we're headed here in New Jersey. So it's awesome.
Damon, congratulations on that deal. When I look at what you what you've done and really established yourself as one of the big time defensemen here for the New Jersey Devils, they have to lean on you quite a bit. You have 203 NHL games, and then the one thing that really jumped out, and Tony just mentioned it, was I can count on one hand because I have five fingers, and that's exactly how many games you've played in the American Hockey League. So you were kind of thrusted into this position, and now you're getting this nice deal. How was that for you, just to kind of get thrown into the fire?
Yeah, I guess, you know what, sometimes I guess it's all about opportunity, and I just kind of came in at the right time with the Devils, and they were just fresh off going to the Cup Finals there against LA, and I got drafted that summer. So they kind of were in need of a couple of young defensemen, and I guess I kind of fit the bill there. So I'm fortunate enough to have that, and now being able to sign this new contract here, I guess it gives me a little bit of a vote of confidence from the management and the ownership, and now just got to prove to them that I'm worth it and get the Devils back into the playoffs.
You mentioned proving that you're worth it. What's a specific area of your game that you want to improve this season?
I think every season I want to improve. Obviously, offensive numbers is a huge thing, me being an offensive-minded defenseman. But the glaring stat that many people, I guess, will look at as a negative for me would be the plus-minus last year. And sometimes it can be a misleading stat, but if you're good in that department, then people won't say that. So that's one thing I do want to improve in is my defensive game and put a lot more pluses on the board. But I guess we got to score more goals to do that as well, but keep the puck out of our net. And we got good goaltending to do it, and we've made some good additions, to put the puck in the other team's net. So hopefully I can turn that around and get it in the right direction.
We are looking forward to watching you and the Devils this year. Congratulations on the new deal.
Thanks, guys.
Drew Doughty, how about this? You got to check out this quote from number 8. This one got a lot of attention because with 2 years left on his deal, my first love will always be LA. It's one of the best organizations in all of sports. Not just hockey, it's unbelievable. They treat us first class, and it's a good place to play. Living in Los Angeles, you can't beat it. I'd love to re-sign in LA, .. But if our team isn't going in the right direction, I want to win cups. I don't give a beep where I play. I just want to win cups. And that's the bottom line. He's got 2 cups on his resume, 2 gold medals. How about those words from him?
Now, this is 2 ends of the spectrums that we're
That's right.
2 ends of the spectrum.
That's exactly
that we're just seeing here.
Yep.
And all I'm going to say to go back to the Sedin thing is when I hear Drew Doughty say that as a player, and I'm not a teammate of his, never have been, that gives me goosebumps.
You'd like to play with
him. I'd love to play with him.
Yep.
Whether it was in Los Angeles or somewhere else, because you want those hungry guys. So the fact that you, on one end, you can perceive it to be a little passive in some ways.
Uh-huh.
This isn't. This is aggressive. He wants it. He thinks about it. He sweats and bleeds for it. That's the guys you want to go into a game with, in the playoffs with, to create memories with. So I love that he said that. And if anything, it sends a little bit of a notification to the Los Angeles Kings as well. Let's make sure this ship's heading in the right direction, or else you're going to be without this guy. And I don't care what anybody says, this guy's still the best defenseman in the National Hockey League.
Won the Norris last year. What about the timing of it? Before the season, after the coaching change, a whole lot of shakeup, upheaval for the Kings after those 2 cups in 3 years, just 1 playoff win in the next 3 years. What about the timing of his statement?
I think it's perfect timing. It's perfect timing because you know what? You've got players that get their feet put to the fire. Well, you know what? He just did the same thing to management there, just letting them know that, hey, I love it here. Why wouldn't you? You get to live in California. You get to live in Los Angeles. But I care more about Stanley Cups than nice warm weather. If that means chasing it in Vancouver or sure. Winnipeg, I don't think Drew Doughty would blink at it. He'd be up there because he wants to win. So I think it's perfect timing. I don't know if it was calculated or not, but he said it, and I respect it and really get you going.
This will get fans going. Look at who's going to come up in the 2019 UFA D class.
Uh-oh.
Are you serious? This is like a Christmas list to end all Christmas. Are you serious? Look at these guys. Some of the best of the era, all coming up at the same time. Wow.
I can't imagine really any of these teams letting any of those guys go, but
hard to believe.
Yeah,
right.
But I would think that you might have some squeak out, but the fact that it's all happening at the same time, you talk about a flooded market. None of those guys want all those guys on the screen to be hitting UFA
that's
at the
right.
same time.
That's right.
Because that's bad news if they all hit at the same time. But that's a lot of talent, and those are guys you can't just swoop in and snag a Ryan McDonough or even a Ryan Ellis, Oliver Ekman-Larsson. I mean. I still remember back in the day when the New York Rangers traded with the Montreal Canadiens for Ryan McDonough. And I remember listening to the media in Montreal saying, he's going to be a stud. And he certainly is. Oh, and those guys don't come around very often. So that's a lot of talent. But these teams know you got to lock them up. And I'm sure they will do every effort to do that.
You just mentioned the Canadiens. We have to dive into Alex Galchenyuk. Perhaps bad news for him. Mark Bergevin, very strong in his wording about the center situation. Bergevin, the executive VP and GM of the Habs. I've been here for 6 years. I've seen Alex every day. And at this time, centerman is a tough position. It's demanding. I'm sure as we speak today, Alex is not able to play that position every day. And I don't need 10 more tries. I know he's not. Wow. Hot take. Whoa. Wow.
You know what? And he's not wrong. I mean, he would know. He's been there. He's got
up close.
Up close and personal. And Alex Galchenyuk, on both sides, really, it's been a frustrating relationship, I believe, for both of the player and the organization over the years because he showed such promises, had such high expectations. They haven't always been met. But at the same time, I think from a standpoint of he has kind of been their defaulted first-line center. They're trying to force him into that over the years. He's has great talent. No one's going to deny that. He can put the puck in the net. He can create offense. That's what you need from your first line. But the only problem I have is if you took all the first line centers in the National Hockey League, the majority of them are not two-way players.
Mm.
But they generate offense. That's what you need that first line center to do. He does do that. So let's not pretend that, these other guys are all both great two-way. So my point is the team identity, it's a little different in Montreal where it's defense first. You got Claude Julien as coach. I played for him. It is defense first.
Sure.
I guess my point being is they have to get points. They have Carey Price. They have Shea Weber. They're structurally sound. They're coached phenomenally. But they need to get offense. And when they picked up Jonathan Drouin, not for a second did I think that Jonathan Drouin was going to play wing. I thought he was going to be in the center position because that's what they need. But are you really getting anywhere if you move Drouin to center and Galchenyuk to wing? I mean, when you look right there, Philip Deneau has been very nice. Thomas Plekanec, that's where he should be slotted. Torrey Mitchell's a great complimentary player, but if you're going to lose offense by moving Galchenyuk to the wing, and they have in the past, it's not worth it for me.
Mm.
It's just you need to milk all the forwards for whatever offense you can. That's been the story for this team for years before Mark Bergevin got there. It's been the lack of scoring offense and creating offense from their forwards. They don't have D that necessarily do that and complement that, but they've got great goaltending, great D structure, great leader in Shea Weber. It's spicy. You got it right. And I don't know if it's a move to push Alex Galchenyuk and get him going. It certainly should, but I think we're starting to see if he is at wing and unhappy and unproductive, I think this is starting to be the beginning of the end for the relationship here with the Montreal Canadiens and Galchenyuk, because this has been ongoing for a long time. But I just think, you know, Jonathan Drouin, his competitiveness is outstanding. He works all over the ice, but he's got a lot of holes in his defensive side of the game too. So let's not fool ourselves. You've got two guys like that. Let's play to their strengths, get some goals. We've got Carey Price. He'll bail you out most times. I don't know. I'd like to see both guys at center.
So Biz Nasty touching on that club, and it's a team. We saw that board, additions and subtractions, and you pointed out the Shane Doan absence, and what will that mean? How about Mike Smith? I've heard you say before, he kept them in a lot of games. Antti Raanta, is he ready to be their number one?
Yeah, and the one thing I want to say, and I'm glad Biz mentioned it right there, is this team for me over the last number of years, it sounds kind of funny saying it, because I think, you know, they were one of the bottom teams in the league the last few years, but Dave Tippett had this team overachieving. And they were a team that wasn't built very good. They had a lot of holes in their lineup. They had a great coach that had a structured game that really kept them in a lot, and they had a goaltender and Mike Smith that would just single-handedly keep them in games on some nights. So they're without him now.
Yep.
And they're younger now. What does that mean? They got Derek Stepan. I think he's ready to tackle this opportunity to really be the leader in Arizona. But this is a game, the way the NHL has turned with this youth movement, it's a league now where if you're young, you can be impactful. We're seeing that. Connor McDavid won league MVP in year two.
Yep.
And it doesn't stop at him, all these great players. But when you have a team made up, look at that. You got Domi, Duclair, big pressure year for him. What's he gonna do? Clayton Keller, Christian Dvorak, you can go on and on. I mean, Dylan Strome's figured in right there. I mean, there's a lot of great talent, high promise for this team, but 82 game season is a long season. Mentally, that's what gets you as a young player. And they don't have Shane Doan. Rick Tocchet's he's the right guy for the job. And this team's got their hands full with which way it can go. And you don't have a goalie to keep you in, so it could get ugly some nights. So it's interesting to see which direction and how quick this team can get going, because they have the talent.
We are thrilled to welcome George Parros to the show. Congratulations on this post. Why is this the right move for you?
I'm certainly excited to take on a new opportunity, and we wish Stefan Quintal all the best. He's going to stick around for us for the next year with the department. He did a fantastic job, and I've got some big shoes to fill. But I'm certainly looking forward to taking over the reins and performing this job to the best of my abilities.
George, maybe premature to ask this, but is there one thing in particular that you've looked over the game in the last little while and have been like, this is the first thing I want to tackle?
Right. It's a good question, Mike. I was thinking about things like that even maybe when I was playing, and certainly into retirement, and maybe you have as well. But one thing I've been mentioning to everybody is that really when you think about it and look at the numbers, the game today is obviously fast-paced, but all the numbers that we track are trending in the right direction. Suspensions down, injuries, certain infractions, headshots, certainly. Everything's heading in the right direction. Obviously, no concussions and no injuries. No supplemental discipline is the goal, but perhaps the lofty one at that. But, there's no major overhaul needed, I don't think. We've done a pretty good job of being consistent, transparent in this department, something we pride ourselves on. But certainly when I took over, there's a couple things I wanted to draw attention to. And we will be taking a closer look at and scrutinizing more all these flashes everyone's talking about. It's kind of hot button the last couple of years. And I'm actually in Buffalo right now and have had discussions with Colin Campbell in the hockey operations group and with Stephen Walkham in the officiating group. It's important we're all on the same page. And I think that, although there's, 700-800 minor penalties called for slashing in the last year, we're not going to be suspending all those, obviously, but we're going to be taking a closer look at them.
We took a close look at you as a player, and we remember what kind of game you had. How does that benefit you in this role?
Well, part of our mission statement, obviously to keep a playing environment as safe as possible for these guys, but also to maintain physicality in the game. It's a line that we walk in a delicate balance, something we're very keen on and aware of. And so I think I'm uniquely suited for the position because, like you said in the wonderful intro there, I was never fine just spending, I'd like to think I played the game as physically as most or anybody. So I kind of knew where that line was, and I'll try and hold guys to that same standard.
And with that being said, the way you played the game, and not always is this the thing that's going on when we see this supplemental discipline, but there's always going to be the fact of the matter, you got to slow down certain players on the other team, and maybe now we're seeing more of the slashes involved, like you mentioned. But you playing in that role and a role similar to my own, it's something where you got to keep that physicality involved in the game, but talk about just the way you approach the game and the way you believe the game should be played. Those things, you're always going to have guys trying to slow guys down and just trying to find that line of what is good and what is not.
Right, right. Well, I think, you know, Mike, a player like yourself as well, you know, you're a pretty honest guy, and there weren't too many surprises when playing or lining up against you. And just like myself, you know, no one liked to see a guy taking advantage of in a vulnerable position. You know, I'd certainly like to put a body on anybody I could and make my presence felt out there, as you did. But, you know, the whole idea behind that was, you know, not to take advantage of a guy. And you're not trying to injure him, per se. You want to make sure your hits are clean and the message is sent in the right way. And I certainly never look to, take advantage of the guy. I see him with his back to me, head down the boards. It's a fast game now. Things happen at high speeds. We're well aware of that. We get to look at plays a lot from a lot of different angles and a lot of different times over and over again, slow motion. So we like to get the play right. But when you're taking advantage of somebody in a poor position, then that's something that perks us up and we look at a lot more closely.
I was thankful to be able to take advantage of the opportunity to visit player safety, Damon Echevarrieta and Patrick Burke, showing me the inner workings. And being there on a game night, I realized just how many people are involved. For those that aren't as familiar with it, you're heading up the department, but you have a lot of help, and I know that that's something you value.
Absolutely. That room is a living, breathing organism. It's got a lot of TVs in there. We got a lot of coordinators that are tirelessly watching all the games and clipping plays and sending them out to us. Damon Echevarrieta, he's been with the league for about 20 years. He was helping out Colum when he started doing this same job a long time ago and cutting VHS footage, I think. So he's been there from the very beginning. Patrick Burke as well has been there for about 5 years. He worked under Shanny, worked under Q. These guys, they know everything inside and out. They got the rule book down. They've seen all the comparable clips that we call attention to. And like I said, one thing we try to do in this department is be consistent, be transparent, have good communication. And I think having these two guys on board really helps us with consistency. And, of course, having Stefan as well on board this year will aid in that as well.
We know the department is in good hands with you. Congratulations, and we look forward to working with you.
I appreciate it, guys. Thanks for having me on.
Henrik Lundqvist, one of the real thrills about doing our job is that you'll admire a player for years and then you'll get to meet him and you'll find out he's the real deal. You played with him. You know how celebrated he is. His attitude, his approach, in order to be a rock star right away, the way Weeksy said, how has he been able to do it?
It's crazy because when he broke in the league, I was right across the Hudson in New Jersey playing for the Devils, and we had Marty Brodeur.
Yep.
And Marty Brodeur, still in my mind, is the best goalie to ever play the game. But Henrik Lundqvist made it pretty tough on Marty for a few years there and really busted onto the scene and really established. I mean, the fact that you could take over and get the nickname the King, he took over New York City from day one.
Yep.
Second, in Weeksy said it best on the intro to this piece, he grabbed a hold of the Rangers and really made the New York Rangers relevant once again.
Yep.
And when they had that backbone, that's certainly what he is. And you talk about goalies all the time. Well, he's our backbone. This guy is legitimately the backbone of the New York Rangers, has been for a very long time. So he is the most fierce competitor I've ever played with. And
great
I've played
compliment.
With a lot of great ones.
Wow.
And he wants it. And if there's a guy you are rooting for to win a cup, Me personally, it's Henrik Lundqvist, because he is, as much as he is a rock star, like Weeksy said, and you always see him GQ look.
Seriously.
Nice suit.
Come on.
Most approachable guy, real guy.
Down to earth.
From that interview right
there. Yeah.
He's heartfelt, and you root for those kind of guys.
Absolutely. And it's not easy being the goalie in New York. Mike Richter did a great job of it. It's tremendous pressure. He handles it with grace. And we shift our focus to Bo Horvat. It's good to be Bo. 6-year, $33 million deal, AAV of 5.5 for a guy who had such a productive year. The general manager, Jim Benning, on this decision.
I'm happy to announce to our fans that we were able to sign Bo to a new 6-year contract. So it's an exciting day for us. He was our top scorer on the team last year. Our fans voted him MVP, and so it's an exciting day. You know, we talked to their representatives, and they had, good points to make, and then we would counter them. And these big deals just take time. And I think this last couple weeks, there was some movement on both sides, and we were able to get it done.
It is a big deal to sign this guy because Rupper, look at those numbers. What a year. And as Benning pointed out, he was the leading scorer on a team with the Sedins. That hadn't happened in a very long time. What about your take on this agreement?
Well, Bo knows. Bo knows hockey. Nice. Bo knows some bank right now, too. Nice deal for Bo Horvat. Very nice deal for the Vancouver Canucks, because you just heard GM Jim Benning saying right there that he was their leading scorer. He's a unique player nowadays, because he's kind of what I would consider the modern-day power forward, and there's not too many guys like that. I mean, he's 225 pounds. You're not going to push him around, and when he gets going downhill, look out. He can do things skillfully, very, very well, but he's a straight-line guy that sometimes you just need guys to keep it simple out on the ice, and you know what to expect from them, and that's what you get in a Bo Horvat. So fantastic signing for both sides. This is the future of the Vancouver Canucks right here.
An awesome storyteller joins us right now. We were just talking about the Yotes, and Biz Nasty is hitting the airwaves. It's our thrill to bring Paul Bissonnette on the show. How does a guy with 1 million Twitter followers make his way into the media? How do you feel about it?
I feel great. I'm excited to be back in the desert. Actually, the last time I headed here for the first time, Rupper was just signed with the Penguins and told me I'd love it because I got picked up off waivers at a training camp.
I remember that.
Yeah.
No, remember, and this is why I think you're going to be unbelievable at this. Number one, you got a great personality, team first guy. But I remember when I signed in Pittsburgh and came in the locker room, one of my first few days there, I didn't know. I was used to playing against Crosby and Malkin and all the greats in Pittsburgh there. I come walking in the locker room and listen to this guy ripping on Evgeny Malkin. And I'm like, where does this guy come from? Like, he could talk to Evgeny, but Evgeny Malkin loved Biz. Everybody did.
Yep.
Has ever played with him and even against him. So you will be certainly perfect for this role, because you're not afraid to say what you think.
Yeah, I mean, I played 15 games a year before, and there's probably not a guy who's more comfortable coming in after playing only 15 games and ripping on a guy who's probably arguably one of the best Russian players ever play.
The one thing that really jumps out to me, excuse me, is you've played at a few different spots here, but you did something in Arizona, whether, with that team and that fan base just absolutely cherishes you. So how important and how great is this for you to be back in the fold? And what does the Arizona Coyotes mean to Paul Bissonnette?
Well, I mean, ever since I left, I've kept in touch with a lot of people here, and it just felt like home. You know, I was fortunate enough to get picked up off waivers and then spend, the majority of my NHL career here. I met my girlfriend here. So just to be able to come back and stay in the game, right away, it's huge. I mean, if you could probably speak to it too, is getting to stay in the game after, and it's really all we know. So to get to talk about it now for a living is awesome, and I couldn't be happier.
What we've known about this club is all changing. So much turnover. You've got a new head coach. There's so many moving parts. Tell us what you think about this club going into the season.
Well, I mean, just the way the league's looking now, it's just going younger and younger. And I mean, as far as they're drafting, they've done exceptionally well. They've made a few key moves, getting Charmelson. They got Ranta, and I like the team. It's unfortunate that Chychrun got hurt training this summer, because he was gonna, he would have been a big help in the back end, especially to start the year. Looking at the road schedule they have, but I mean, even up front, they got some good young talent. So and some hungry guys too. You got Duclair coming off, a not so great year, who's going to be really hungry. So I think it's going to be fun, and I think everyone's excited, especially with a coach that probably thinks the game a lot more offensively than Tippett did. That's not taking it away from Tip. He was for what he had to work with for a few years there, he did a great job. And I think just everyone in general is just excited for the new look and to see how the team plays.
Here's my big question, though, and no better person to ask than you, because you were teammates and good friends with. What is the subtraction or the departure of Shane Doan going to do for this team? Because it is a young team. They're super talented, but very young. And Shane Doan, we both know, and I believe everybody in this hockey world knows, one of the most classiest guys. Or it probably is the most classiest, most guy of integrity, and you know what you're going to get. Great leader. Well, how is this going to influence the Arizona Coyotes, potentially in a bad way?
Yeah, I don't know. That should be interesting, and I think a lot of people are interested to see how it plays out. We just touched on it, how young they are, especially up front. So, I was pretty disappointed for him not to be here, especially my first year back. I thought it would have been a great way for him to help mold the young guys and also have a year where we could send them off properly. But, obviously I'm in a tough position talking about it and being critical about it, because now I got to worry about my boss. But, I mean, I think people know how I feel about it. And he did so much for me in Arizona hockey. And it's been an odd situation this summer. And I know the fans aren't necessarily crazy about it. But, I guess we got to move on.
Biz Nasty, I know what it is to be in a tough position. Coming into this interview, I wasn't sure how it was going to go between you and Rupper, because we look back in NHL. There it is. Look at this.
Look at it. You ripped my jersey in this one. This is the one when I was with the Rangers. And
there was one, I think, when you were with Minnesota, when you just pumped the right side of my face in, and I was bleeding in the box. And
you know what, though?
I had to play that role, and it sucked when you had to fight bears like Rupp. So strong.
I still remember.
You couldn't even get inside on the guy, so it was hopeless going in. And, that one, you got me with a good one. And, whatever. I slept in the dark room a few nights, but I'm all right now.
I remember when I was in New Jersey, and our strength and conditioning coach, Mike Vasilani, at the time, he would love watching hockey fights, and it was when you were going through guys when you were in Pittsburgh, and he kept checking in with me every day. Hey, did you see Paul Bissonnette? He just took it to another guy last night. I beat this guy up. I'm like, who is this guy? And I remember watching him, because in my mind, I'm like, you kind of came out of nowhere. And I was like, I don't know if I want to fight this guy. So I see him a few times up close and personal. So I'm glad we didn't. I got to meet you, first of all. And that was enough for me to nothing but respect for you. So it was great being teammates for a little while there.
I had to learn the hard way in the American League when all the guys came down, when the fighting kind of started deteriorating. And I had to fight the big boys like Yablonski, the nasty Morastis, who was in Syracuse. Yeah. And those boys were chucking weights
every
day.
They're no joke. They're no joke. That's for sure.
Oh no.
Well, we know you are well suited to do the job you're going to be doing. We are thrilled that you're joining the media the way that you are, and we wish you and the Yotes the best this season.
Yeah. Hey, thanks for having me on, guys. Good not having to see Rupper face to face anymore.
Well said. There is one goalie in the history of the National Hockey League that has had 20 wins or more his first 12 seasons. Weeksy said it great. He's been a rock star from day one. We welcome in Henrik Lundqvist, adding a world championship to your resume this offseason to go along with your Olympic gold medal and all of the other celebrated achievements. The first thing Rangers fans want to know, because they remembered your grade one MCL sprain suffered at the Worlds. How are you feeling?
I'm feeling good. You know, I took some time off right after the World Championships and rested up back in Sweden. But then I started training the way I've been training for the past 12, 13 years, and nothing really changed. I just needed maybe an extra couple weeks before I started the training. And I've been skating now since start of August. And, yeah, no issues at all. It just feels really good to be back on the ice. August is always a month where you have to work really hard to get back.
Hank, the one thing that really jumps out to me, and it takes about 2 seconds for you or any other Swede that I've ever played with, very proud of your heritage. And the one thing that impressed me is at the end of the season, how quickly you jumped over to play for Sweden with your brother Joel. And maybe just take us to that moment and how important that is for you to play with your brother, but also represent your country.
Yeah, so I think in that moment, obviously, you're extremely disappointed. You've been working extremely hard for, you know, 9 months to get to that point, and your goal is to go all the way. So you have a couple of days there where you feel really low, but my brother reached out to me. I knew there was an opening to go. And in that moment, you just have to be true to yourself. You have enough energy to reload and go there and perform. You can't just show up and play. You need to be playing at a really high level. But there was just so many things that was in my favor. You know, I haven't played with my brother for 12 years. He was the captain. It was easy to get there for me from New York, and we had a strong team. So I saw a really good opportunity to go there and finish the season on a high note. But I think that the most important thing, though, I grew up with my brother, and our first dream, our first goal really as a hockey player at age 7 or 8 was to play for our country and to stand there on the blue line with a gold medal. And I just saw that vision and that dream leaving New York and go there and try to get it done. And I'm super happy with the tournament. It was a lot of fun and great group of guys. But I must say, standing there on the blue line after we win, we beat Canada in the final, it was an extremely special moment for me and my brother, you know, to share that moment. And that's kind of how it started for us, you know, when it comes to playing the game and starting to dream about big things. It was playing for a country, see the flag go up, and it's a very proud moment.
And we saw what it meant to Sweden when you guys got back to the country and there were tens of thousands waiting to celebrate with you. Keeping our focus across the pond, we know you and Matt Zuccarello have a big event that you're promoting. It's a great idea. Tell the fans about it.
Yeah, so during last season, Matt approached me about this idea of playing an outdoor game in Norway. And, you know, obviously, I've had an opportunity to play 3 outdoor games in the NHL. And I think it's just a great experience for the fans, for the players. So when he asked me, I said yes right away. So now we're doing this August 11th next summer in Oslo at a big soccer stadium. We're going to ask a bunch of our friends and opponents that we get to know over the years and see if they want to come there and play and have a really fun weekend. And all the money and the focus would be on charity.
When I look at you and your pads and your helmet, that screams fun. You have fun with designing your equipment. And you pretty much lit the social media on fire when you released your pads, what they look like.
Oh, yeah.
Liberty. So talk to us about how that came about and how unique and who did your pads.
So when it comes to design, obviously as a goalie, you have an opportunity to express yourself a little bit on the mask. And I think now we're getting into a stage where the pads are going to be more, you know, more design there, because working with Bauer now for a lot of years, they have an opportunity to print the design on the pad. So obviously you can get a lot of detail work in there. So when it comes to my design, I just like sharp edges in my design. I find it more aggressive, and I just like that look. So Statue of Liberty is in there, part of the New York skyline. But it's just the beginning, you know. I probably switched the design a couple of times throughout the season, and we'll see where it ends up. But that's the beauty of technology now, where you can mix it up a little bit, and we'll see where it takes us. But it's definitely a big step here in the way of making a pad and designing a pad. So working with Bauer has been a lot of fun, and the way they use the technology now.
We would be remiss on this date, understanding how much pride you take in being a New Yorker, to not ask you about 9/11, because we know that's something that you have reflected on your gear in the past. I know it's a hard day for every New Yorker. What does 9/11 mean to you?
Well, I've been in New York now for 12 years, and coming here over to my first year, you understood the impact, how people, you know, it was not only companies, it was families, friends, colleagues. They were all impacted by this day, and it, you understand the importance of the day. You reflect, but you also appreciate how the city really came together after it happened. So, I mean, today is it's a big charity day, and just came back from a couple companies here on Wall Street where they do a lot of charitable activities, and all the money raised will go to great causes. So, you know, I really admire the way the city bounced back, and it's important to really not forget and to remember what happened, but also how the city moved on. So as an athlete in the city, of course, you understand the importance, but you also want to be there and try to help and honor, but also support people that's been through it.
Very well said. It was our pleasure having you on. Good luck to you and the Rangers this year.
Thank you so much, guys.